WWNO New Orleans, this is Louisiana Eats. I'm Poppy Tooker. In the world of American food, winning a James Beard Award is the equivalent of receiving an Oscar in Hollywood. Here on Louisiana Eats, we've been fortunate to speak with many members of that exclusive club, often before they received that distinction. 2014 was a big year for Louisiana at the James Beards. Ryan Pruitt was named Best Chef of the South, and along with partners Donald Link and Steven Strajewski, took home Best New Restaurant in America for Pesh. The 75-year-old New Orleans Snowball Stand, Hanson's Snow Blitz, was honored with recognition as a James Beard American Classic. And Chef John Besh became the newest member of the James Beard Who's Who of Food and Beverage in America. It was a winning night for Louisiana, and we're walking the red carpet with our most distinguished food friends on this week's Louisiana Eats. Earlier this year, before the James Beard Award nominations were even announced, we visited Chef Ryan Pruitt at Pesh Restaurant to learn the origins of the restaurant's unique concept, fueled by an entirely new way of cooking.
We had been talking about opening a seafood restaurant for years, and, you know, we were kind of wrestling with what direction the restaurant was going to go. You know, where it all kind of came together is we sort of all fell in love with these cooking techniques. We wanted to open a seafood restaurant, and we just sort of merged the two. It was really a pretty easy merger. You know, the ideas of cooking seafood over fire, I mean, grilled fish tastes great. You know, shrimp on a grill tastes great. And all these things, you know, these are sort of proven concepts. Where it really came together for us is that we wanted it to all happen over an actual wood fire device. Kind of move away from the gas grills and those sort of more controlled cooking elements and have something that has more life to it, that has more energy. And the way that it sort of blossomed and to give us this whole realm of things that we can do with the grill and the ways that we can steer seafood in sort of interesting ways, interesting but not unfamiliar ways, you know, has been really rewarding.
Talk about rewarding. How about awarding? We asked Ryan how it finally felt to be sitting in the James Beard Award audience as a nominee, a distinction that comes by being judged the very best by a jury of your peers.
It's a little overwhelming. I mean, you know, at first you kind of walk in and you're surrounded by every single person whose cookbook you've ever read or restaurant you've ever been to or person you've admired or read about. And all these people are kind of first and foremost and right in front of you. A few drinks later, you just settle into the moment, I think.
Before this year's James Beard Awards, partners Donald Link and Steven Strajewski already claimed three awards between the two of them. Apparently, multiple wins begins to give you a hunger for more. When it first opened, their restaurant Cochon was nominated for Best New Restaurant in America, but didn't win. Now, Pesh was in the running for that same award.
Like when we opened Cochon, the goal wasn't to get nominated for Best New Restaurant. But then when that happened, it kind of changed things. Just realizing that that was an opportunity really kind of made it something that was then suddenly on the radar. When we opened this place, like, it was something that we actually kind of thought about more because Donald had two awards, I had an award, and the idea was a lot more easy to grasp. Like, it seemed like something conceptually that we could do.
Finally, the time had come for the winner of this year's Best Chef of the South to be announced. Here, Ryan gives us a personal account of just what that moment feels like.
You sort of spend the whole night waiting and sitting there repeatedly and continuously tapping my foot and grabbing both my wife and Tommy, our GM here, shoulders in nervousness and rubbing the all of the paint off of a toy car that my kid had given me until the moment when the award, you know, the announcement comes up, and then, you know, everything kind of stops, and when they call your name, I think the whole scene shifts a bit because you have to switch into the mode where you're going to go on stage and actually speak in front of a, you know, large room of very important people. when I did go on stage, I went the wrong way and walked out into the outside aisle, which didn't have a staircase. So I had to jump up a 4-foot ledge to get onto the stage and then come in from the wings, which no one actually knows happened. So I guess it was dark enough that we were able to pull it off. But, you know, you get on stage and you make your acceptance speech short and sweet, and then you're kind of swept backstage into this green room photography area where someone hands you a glass of champagne. And the whole thing just kind of, you know, it lasts like 3 minutes, you know, and it's a very sort of whirlwind moment. And you're kind of like spit out the other side with a glass in one hand and a medal around your neck and, you know, the feeling of, oh, my God, did that really just happen? We are not typically these type of people, but the hotel room was just trash. Like, there was stuff everywhere, and my phone had died about halfway through the night, and so I had plugged it in, I rolled over, and there was 91 unread text messages and just crap everywhere in the room, and then you're just kind of left with, oh my God, yeah, that really did just happen.
James Beard Award-winning chefs and restaurateurs, Steven Strajewski and Ryan Prue. Last spring, John Besh became the newest member of the James Beard Foundation's Who's Who of Food and Beverage in America. Perhaps that's because John not only cooks, writes, and hosts his own cooking show, he even runs a philanthropic organization called Chef's Move. The lucky recipients of the Chef Move Scholarship are minority students from the New Orleans area who receive professional training at the French Culinary Institute in New York City and so much more. In 2011, John introduced us to the very first Chef's Move winner, Serena Johnson. Now, John, explain, why was Serena chosen?
Good gosh. Well, you know, that was a grueling process and one that I truly wanted no part of. But this being the first one, this had to be somebody very special, somebody that understood New Orleans, somebody that had the tenacity that she has, the smarts that Serena has, and the work ethic. Everybody that had worked with Serena at Liberty's Kitchen had all commented on how dedicated. And she came up through the ranks so quickly and then was the first one to actually receive a paying job there supervising others. And so then started supervising the whole lunch crew at one of the schools nearby that they cater to. And so one thing led to another, and she just took the ball and ran with it. I think she made it. She did it, and she deserves it. And she just stood head and shoulders above the crowd.
Well, now we know that Liberty's Kitchen certainly played a hand in that. Serena, would you tell us a little bit about your Liberty's Kitchen experience?
I went there, I filled out an application, they gave me a little stage date, and I went there and I staged, and I brought my chef pants and everything like that. I actually brought like a little notebook that I was writing my notes when I was working with this one chef, and I was like, brought it all in, and she was like, wow, okay, like you really seem like you would be a good fit. So she gave me my date, and I came, and the program is like 12 weeks. I finished in like 6 because if you show that you have all your skills, then they'll let you move on further. So I only stayed like 6-7 weeks. And once I left there, I went to the school and they needed me at the school. So I stayed until I heard about this program.
And tell me about the school. So you got placed in a school lunch program?
Yeah, because we have a contract with New Orleans College Prep School, and we do the school lunch there. So when you're at the school, it's pretty much just serving the kids on the lunch line. You're getting the food prepared in bulk in a bag with the cafeteria and the chefs and stuff. So I started working there, and it was a good fit, and I really liked it. So they hired me, and it started all
and she's
working.
Being very humble. Not only did they hire her, she took control. She cracked down on smoke breaks. She saw to it that if you're punched into work, that you're working. And all of a sudden, she became a self-appointed sous chef, if you will, of the school lunch line, and I know this because I've talked to some of her fellow workers, which she had no idea that was also part of the process to get the scholarship.
What? And Serena, I want to hear a little bit from you about your background.
Pretty much, I'm an uptown girl. Born and raised in New Orleans, 21 years. The only year that I left was for the hurricane, and that was to live in Texas, and then we immediately came back. I've been working since I was 16 years old. As soon as I came back from the hurricane, I wanted to work. I wanted to make my own money. I wanted to do things for myself, so I got a job. I worked at McDonald's, my first job, and progressed up from there to start working at August. I've grew up and went to some of the schools that people probably frowned upon, and I grew up with some of the people that right now they're not doing nothing with themselves. To see that I came up and did this, it's like they're looking at me, now they want to do something. It's an inspiration to everybody. I see everybody just want to do something with themselves. They're not even cooking. It's just they trying to better themselves and whatever they trying to do just because they see me do that. So to see me doing this is really like an eye-opener for them. It's making them want to do something better with themselves.
Well, it's pretty rare when you find somebody as young as 21. I know so many people who maybe even are in college at 21, and they don't have a clue what they want to do with their lives. So that's a great gift that you have.
I didn't even think cooking was in the option of something for me to do until I started doing this and started seeing all the good things. Like, chefs, like, they make a decent living, and they love what they do. So I could get with that. This is something that I love to do. I like to create stuff in the kitchen. I like to work with food. I just like the kitchen atmosphere. I'm good with that. I could relate to that. So it's something that I really like doing.
Well, John, I'd like to hear from you about how Serena's New York adventure is going to begin. When does it begin and what's going to happen?
It's so exciting because it's more than just an education. This is really going to encompass a year of mentorship by a number of people, from Marcus Samuelson to Rachel Ray to Aaron Sanchez. And so she'll go through the classes, and then it allows students to work at the same time that they go to school. So if you go to school during the morning, then you can hold a line cook's job at night. And so 9 months of education, she's going to come out with years and years of experience under her belt that she can then bring back to New Orleans. The catch is that we want her to stay with us for a year. During that internship, she'll work a rounds position and get to know Restaurant August right off the bat and get a good, well-rounded view of what this is all about. The second catch is that she needs to stay in New Orleans for 5 years. And because you can already see she's a leader.
Yes.
She's got a lot of get up and go and some great attributes that we want people to emulate. And she's going to be here in the community as a witness to the potential out there. I want people to know that you can make better than just a decent living, Serena. You can make a great living in this industry. But it's just such a shame that more people, more New Orleanians, don't realize that.
Serena, you have referred to yourself as, and I'm quoting directly, the poster child for dreams come true. Tell me, what are your dreams for the future?
I really want to come back and try to do something like what Liberty's Kitchen or Reconcile is trying to do. If I can give back to the youth like me who want to learn, who don't really have the means to do it and don't know where to start from, I guess I want to do something like that, try to be an instructor, give them inspiration, or try to help them on making their goals come true, making their dreams come true too. So I want to help them as much as possible. And I don't plan on leaving New Orleans. I don't need a 5-year stipulation. I'm going to come back. I love my city. This is my city, and I want to stay here and just uplift my community.
Well, thank you so much, the both of you, for coming to see us today at Louisiana Eats.
Thank you so much for having us, Poppy.
Serena Johnson and John Besh, our newest James Beard Foundation's Who's Who of Food and Beverage in America. We'll be right back.
year, the James Beard Foundation recognizes cherished, local, often family-owned food businesses distinguished by their timeless appeal, as well as the place they hold in local food culture. This year, the America's Classic honor was awarded to Hanson Snowblitz, the place where the unique style of New Orleans snowball was invented. Food writer Scott Gold explains why Hanson Snowblitz continues to be so popular in the Crescent City, even after 75 years.
When Hanson Snowblitz opened for the season this year, it was hardly what you'd call snowball weather. The day was lugubriously gray, damp, and chilly, the kind of weather you'd expect to find in Oregon rather than in New Orleans. Still, that didn't keep people from literally lining up around the block to taste their first snowball of the season. To some, this would seem silly. To others, a kind of obsession, or even addiction. Folks packed into a block-long queue for a cold dessert treat like junkies at a methadone clinic. And to this I say, if you don't understand why someone would wait for 45 minutes in the damp chill for shaved ice and sugary syrup, you've clearly never experienced a Hanson snowball. Like many other iconic foods treasured by New Orleanians, there are snowballs, and then there are snowballs. It's the same with the roast beef po' boy, an oyster loaf, crawfish bisque, fried chicken, or barbecued shrimp. These dishes abound in the Big Easy, but there's always one place that clearly stands above the rest. Usually, it's the one you first experienced as a child, and even more often, the one that your parents or even grandparents first experienced as children. At 75 years young, Hanson's is thought to be the oldest snowball stand in the country. Ashley Hanson took over the shop from her beloved grandparents, Ernest and Mary Hanson, and continues to run it today. If you've never had the pure, unabashed joy that is a Hanson snowball, you're missing out on one of the finest creations New Orleans has ever offered humankind. It's right up there with jazz as far as I'm concerned. The first thing you'll notice when you dig into a snowblizz is the texture of the ice, immediately distinctive among all other shaved ice concoctions. It's so fine, soft, and perfectly fluffy, you'd think you were eating fresh powder directly off the top of an alpine peak. But Hanson's only begins with ice. You couldn't have a true New Orleans snowball without syrups and toppings, and this is where the snowblizz truly breaks away from the pack. Sure, they have the basics, lemon, spearmint, watermelon, bubblegum, and so forth, but Ashley Hanson has added to the menu new, sometimes exotic, and always lovingly handmade syrup flavors, all of which can be combined with any of the others. The result is a nearly vertiginous variety of possible flavor profiles, including honey lavender, ginger cayenne, blueberry cardamom, anise and cream of chocolate, and more. So much more. Top that off with some thick condensed milk and a dash of sprinkles or crushed strawberries, which is particularly amazing with lemon, and you have a treat that will make you forget whatever it was that might have been bothering you before you spooned that snowball into your mouth. It's just delicious. So congrats on 75 years, Hanson's. Here's to 75 more, and 75 more after that.
Food writer and native New Orleanian Scott Gold. His Food Porn Fridays column can be found each week at nolavie.com. What was it about James Beard that made him so legendary in America? Stay tuned, and when we come back, we'll learn how James Beard began a food revolution. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen and Zatarain's. Here's this week's culinary quiz question, brought to you with support from Popeye's Louisiana Culinary Institute. What was it about James Beard that made him so legendary in America? In the 1940s, James Beard laid the groundwork that eventually elevated classic American culinary traditions into a true national cuisine. He had the very first cooking show, wrote a library of classic cookbooks, and was an early champion of local products and farmers markets. After his death in 1985, Peter Kump joined forces with Julia Child and other American chefs to purchase Beard's historic Greenwich Village townhouse, where the James Beard Foundation was created. In 1990, the foundation established the annual James Beard Awards, which today is widely recognized as the highest honor given in America's food world. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats. Chris Jay is a food blogger for the Shreveport-Bossier Convention and Tourism Bureau. His weekly blog covering the food scene in northwestern Louisiana can be found every Tuesday on 20by49.com. Chris is also our North Louisiana Eats roving reporter, and he's always got some fresh new food talk from way up north. So, Chris, welcome back.
Thanks for having me again, Poppy.
What's happening new?
Oh, man. Everyone's talking about Chef Corey Barr's new restaurant, Nana, in Monroe. It is spectacular, and it is just knocking people's socks off all along the I-20 corridor.
Corey's new restaurant, Nana, has really just opened, hasn't it?
Yes, I was there on the second night they were in business, and I was surrounded by the cast and crew of Duck Dynasty, which was pretty wild. I hear that they're there quite often and are big fans of Corey Barr. It's kind of brilliant and entertaining and just amazing how he has incorporated traditional Italian foods plus locally sourced ingredients to create something just completely unique, at least to our area.
Well, set the stage for us. What does the restaurant look like?
Oh, that's arguably the most fantastic part. I mean, it is this restored, renovated garden district home in Monroe. Mm. Just a beautiful old home. It kind of looks like grandma's house, which is perfect because, you know, Nana is Italian for grandmother. The restaurant is decorated hilariously. There are all these beautiful portraits of local grandmothers from Monroe.
Hilarious.
There's a bocce ball court attached to the restaurant and a courtyard dining area with its own bar so that after you eat, you can go outside and play bocce ball and drink. It's wonderful.
Well, what do you eat at Corey's new restaurant?
Well, speaking about combining the traditional Italian and the Louisiana Delta ingredients, I would definitely recommend the crab gnocchi. I would recommend the smothered rabbit pappardelle. One of the most incredible things I had was a fried oyster carbonara, which was, you know, local oysters in this really rustic style Italian carbonara, which is wonderful. One of the most interesting things on the menu, in my opinion, is an arancini dish. And I may be pronouncing that incorrectly.
It's arancini.
Arancini. And it's made with smoked ham hocks. So it kind of combines this Italian fried rice ball with a boudin ball that we already know and love. But it's like the most incredible, mind-blowing combination of two things. And it's just wholly unique.
And what are the price points like?
You could totally eat dinner there for $20.
Are you kidding?
Absolutely not. I mean, if you want to have some drinks, you want to have some appetizers, it's definitely $20 and up. But you could go have an unforgettable meal for $20 there.
Well, I'm getting in the car and driving north. I got to see my buddy Corey, and we'd love to hear from him again on Louisiana Eats soon anyway. I love that, Corey. He's so creative. He's so fresh. And my goodness, he's one busy man.
Not a bad-looking guy either.
No, he's not a bad-looking guy either. Well, thank you so much for taking us on the spot to undoubtedly what I'm hearing is the biggest buzz happening in the restaurant scene in central Louisiana.
It was my pleasure, Poppy. Thanks for having me.
Thanks, Chris. Chris Jay, our Louisiana Eats roving reporter. Down with soul food scholar Adrian Miller, he took us on a historical tour of his favorite soul food dishes. We discussed everything from the West African roots of red drink to the European history of mac and cheese. After you hear Adrian's insight into the soul food diaspora, you'll understand why his book won this year's James Beard Award for reference and scholarship. In your book, for the first time, I got a little explanation about the chicken and waffle phenomena. Tell us what's up with that.
So there's a great creation myth about chicken and waffles. So the story that's usually told is that it starts in Harlem in the Jazz Age, 1920s and 30s, because the club goers were getting out of the clubs at about 3 in the morning, right? So it's too late for dinner, too early for breakfast. So this enterprising restaurateur named Joseph Wells decides to make a hybrid dish of fried chicken and waffles. And that took place there, and it's been popular ever since. Well, it's a great story, but it's not true. Chicken and waffles actually comes from old Europe and lands in the Pennsylvania countryside thanks to the German immigrants there. So we call them Pennsylvania Dutch, which is imprecise because it's Pennsylvania Deutsch. But they bring a creamed chicken and waffle tradition with them. And so it...
Creamed chicken.
Right. And then it starts...
No maple syrup anywhere.
No maple syrup anywhere. And then it gets to Philadelphia and becomes this elite dish and then makes its way south in elite homes. So by 1800s, you got Thomas Jefferson eating fried chicken on a morning where there's going to be a hunt, or a Sunday morning, or a weekend morning, or anytime they're having guests. And the way to think about fried chicken and waffles is think of it as fried chicken and any kind of hot bread. So if you look at the historical sources, it could be biscuits, it could be pancakes, it could be rolls or anything like that. Now, fried chicken and waffles goes big time in the 1800s, and it shows up on elite hotel menus. You know, we had presidents. McKinley talked about meeting his wife at a chicken and waffle dance. It was big time. Then it falls out of favor in white culture, and then it exists in black subculture for decades, and then it becomes big time again in the 2000s. And I'm trying to figure out why it becomes big again. But look, I think you should try it, because what I do...
Well, tell me how you eat it.
So I eat it separately, right? So I just eat the same way I would eat a chicken and a waffle. So I put my butter and syrup on the waffle, put my hot sauce on the chicken, and just have it. You know, I think it's a good thing.
I'll reconsider. I'm kind of a chicken and biscuit girl. So you have a whole chapter on why black-eyed peas are superstitiously considered to be lucky.
Mm-hmm.
What's the deal with that?
Yeah, so that was a fun chapter to check out. So there's no corollary for black-eyed peas necessarily meaning good luck on New Year's Day in West Africa. So it's really an old Europe superstition that African-Americans end up embracing. So a lot of European traditions had this idea that, and it wasn't food necessarily gets transferred to food, but the idea was that on New Year's Day, you have to have somebody with dark hair and dark eyes be the first one to knock on your door. If that happens, then you would have a good year. And so,
you and I should make some rounds.
Yeah, exactly. Well, you have more hair than I do, so I don't know if bald dudes counted. You have that tradition. And then in West Africa, the cowpeas were often associated with deities. So with certain deities, they were the favorite foods. And so they were often used for blessings for twins or births or other things. So you can see that cowpeas had this specialness. Uh-huh. So now you get to the Americas and you've got this tradition about the black eyes. And also in West Africa, black eyed peas were often considered an amulet for good luck because it warded off the evil eye. Yeah. And so you see these things kind of come together. Now, the other part that I didn't talk about in my book, which I wish I explored more, is you have Sephardic Jews from around the world having black-eyed peas on Rosh Hashanah. And some believe that the Talmud, the Babylonian Talmud, says that you are to have black-eyed peas. And so there were early communities of Sephardic Jews in Charleston and Savannah, and there may have been an influence there.
That's fascinating.
I think so, too.
Boy, there's nothing quite as delicious as food history.
Right,
huh?
Yeah.
In every single way.
Yeah.
Now, you almost left what is considered today to be part of the soul food genre out of your book, macaroni and cheese.
Mm-hmm.
So how did it get included? And what was your thought process on all that?
Well, I just thought macaroni and cheese is identifiably Italian, but also I just thought it was so mainstream that it would be hard to make a soul food connection. But so many of my African-American friends just threatened to slap me upside my head that I just could, I caved to peer pressure. So that's why I included it. And I'm glad I did, because I found out a fascinating history of mac and cheese, how it starts as this very elite dish. So in the Middle Ages, European royalty was grubbing on macaroni and cheese.
Now, really?
It wasn't the goopy mess that we love today. It was pretty much just the pasta with Parmesan cheese shavings on it. So it was this rich person's dish, again, for a lot of years.
Probably had some truffles, too.
Probably, right? And then cream and other things start to get added to it. And so it enters African-American cooking because it comes to the big houses of the South, again, as an elite dish. And some credit Thomas Jefferson for spreading this around, but I think it was around before he was on the scene. And so African-Americans were often doing the cooking, and I think that's how it enters into our cuisine. Now, it starts to come down the social ladder because of two things. One, because it was very expensive to get Parmesan cheese and also to get the imported macaroni. So American farmers became very good at making, growing durum wheat, which is necessary for true macaroni. And then also we got, the American dairy industry got really good at making cheddar cheese, which was an acceptable substitute for Parmesan cheese. So the cheddar cheese that we have today is different from what they were making 200 years ago. And from what cheese experts tell me, old British cheddar was very similar to Parmesan.
Ah.
And so when those two things get cheap, then you start to see the price of macaroni and cheese come down. And so it leaves this elite status and becomes more of a working people's dish. And then, of course, in the 1930s, the advent of the blue box changed everything. So it became a real convenience food.
Yeah. Now, before I read your book, Soul Food, I never realized the importance of what's known as red drinks in a typical soul food meal. What is the red drink, and explain why it's so important?
All right. So you have to understand that in soul food circles, red is a flavor, okay? So the red could be red Kool-Aid. I think red Kool-Aid is the official soul food drink.
Okay.
But it could be fruit punch. It could be strawberry soda. And it just has to be red. So what I found is, just before I even wrote the book, I just noticed in most communal settings, there usually is some kind of red drink. And even in soul food restaurants, there's usually some kind of red drink offered. And I was just wondering, well, what's that about? And so I looked back and I found out that there are several ancestral red drinks that crossed the Atlantic during the slave trade. And they're ones that people have had but probably didn't even know. So one is cola. And I know people saying, what is this dude talking about? Colas are brown. Well, if you turn around the bottle or the can, there's always caramel coloring. So cola nuts, the main ones are either white or red. And a red cola nut tea was often used as a means of hospitality. So you welcome someone, you can give them cola nuts and they can just chew them there. Mm-hmm. They have a red cola tea. And that's very popular. And then also hibiscus tea. So in West Africa, it's called bisop, but there's a hibiscus tea that comes across, lands in Jamaica. And if you've traveled in the Caribbean, you've probably have heard of sorrel, which is a Christmas time drink. That's that West African flower. Now, it starts to make its way around Latin America and South America, and it starts to be called agua de Jamaica. So if you go to a Mexican restaurant and get agua de Jamaica, you're drinking that West African drink.
That's fascinating.
Yeah. And it's the same formula as Kool-Aid, right? For cola nut teas and for the hibiscus tea. You get some water, you color it red, and sweeten it to taste.
Okay, man. I never thought I'd hear red Kool-Aid lionized quite like that.
Now, I have to say, there is a generational shift happening. Yes. A lot of youngins seem to like purple drink more.
Oh.
And that's distressing to me. I say this in my book. I believe the children are our future, that we should teach them well and let them lead the way, but I'm not sure what red drinks.
Adrian Miller, the author of Soul Food, The Surprising Story of an American Cuisine, winner of the 2014 James Beard Award for Reference and Scholarship. When it comes to the James Beard Awards, it truly is an honor just to be nominated. When we come back, we'll hear from two of this year's nominees, chefs Alon Shaya and John Kearns. Stay tuned. Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is made possible with major support from Rouse's Markets. Even though Ryan Pruitt took home the 2014 James Beard Award for Best Chef of the South, the local competition was stiff. Chef Alon Shaya of Dominica Restaurant was also nominated. In this excerpt from Alon's interview with us in 2011, he talks about the impact food had on his life at an early age.
People ask me how did I get into cooking, and I always say, like, cooking kind of found me. Like, I didn't go out searching to want to be a cook. It was something that just was always in my lap, and one day I just embraced it. It started for me at a very young age. I was born in Israel, and my family immigrated when I was 4 years old to Philadelphia. A year after we immigrated to Philadelphia, my parents got divorced, and so my mother was now a single mother raising two kids.
How old were you at that time?
I was 5, and my sister was 10. So, you know, it was a very tough time for our family. We were very poor. My father had been already in America for 2 years saving up money to bring the family out. And then we come out, and then they get divorced. And so it was just a very, very hard time for the family. And so you know, my mom had a lot of stress on her shoulders, and she had to work very, very hard just to keep a roof over our heads. And so she worked two jobs. And because she worked two jobs, my sister and I, you know, we had chores, lots of chores, because she wasn't home a lot. And at the age of 10, my sister was watching me, and we had to cook and we had to clean. And when my sister was 15, she moved out of the house. And so then it was just my mother and I. And I was 9, 10 years old at the time. So my mom was still working two jobs, and I would come home from school every day around 3 o'clock. And I was in first and second grade at the time. And it was up to me to get dinner ready. It wasn't because I had this big passion for cooking at the time. It was because we needed to eat.
It was a necessity.
It was a necessity. And so when I was in first grade, I would walk 3 blocks from my house to the grocery store and go shopping for groceries and bring them home and start doing preparations for dinner. And so I didn't think it was anything extraordinary or unusual. It was just the way it was. And, you know, I had been doing it for years with my sister prior to that. So one day I was in the grocery store and I was in second grade, and my second grade teacher runs into me and says, "Oh, what are you doing here? Where's your mom?" And I said, "Oh, she's working. You know, I'm here getting food for dinner." And she was like, "What? Really? You're here shopping all by yourself?" And I said, "Yeah, I've been doing this since I was in first grade." And so she was blown away by that. And I didn't understand why she thought it was such a big deal. And then the next day in class, she singles me out in front of the whole class and says, "I just want everybody to know that Alon was in the grocery store buying groceries by himself." And everybody looked at me like, "Wow, you're allowed into the grocery store by yourself?" And I was like, "Yeah, what's the big deal? I don't understand." And so this is just the way that it began. It's the way that it was handed to me. And I had to just take that and do something with it. And as time went on, I kind of realized how important that was. As a kid in high school, I was not the model student. I would get in a lot of trouble. None of my teachers really wanted to have anything to do with me, except for my home economics teacher, Donna Tarkov. And so when I would get kicked out of one class, instead of sending me to detention, they would send me to Mrs. Tarkov's class, because she was really the only one that would accept me. Even the detention person didn't want anything to do with me. And so I would go to Mrs. Tarkov's class, and she'd give me a whole box full of onions and say, "Slice these onions up and do it fast." And that settled me down. And she eventually got me a job, my first job at a restaurant. And she said, "You better show up on time. You better be dressed right. I'm going to call your boss every day and make sure that you're doing the right thing." And she did. And she kept me in line. And she was really the only one that I would listen to. And so I started working in kitchens and eventually went to culinary school and then did internships and then became a chef, you know, as the years went by. And it was last year that Mrs. Tarkov came to Dominica, and we spent a week in the kitchen together, and it was just one of the most special moments for me, special moments for her. And she came and made pizzas with us, and she went up to the farms with us and saw the vegetables and the animals. And she's become a very proud teacher. And she says all the time, she says, if I could have made a difference in one person's life, then my job was totally worth it, all these years of teaching. And so she, to this day, is a huge influence in my life. And hopefully I gave her a little sense of accomplishment. And I'm sure she's had many senses of accomplishment, but hopefully I was able to contribute to that.
Well, I am sure that she is very proud of you. And I have a feeling your mom must be pretty proud, too. Thank you, Alon.
Thank you.
Alon Shaya, chef of Dominica Restaurant. Writing
pigs and whiskey took longer than expected, but Chef John Currents was rewarded for his efforts with a 2014 James Beard nomination. Not bad for your first book. John recently joined us to talk about his desire to bring real food back to the table.
The greatest diet that'll never make the bestseller list is called moderation.
Yeah.
And sacrifice. And to another point, like anticipation.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're not going to wait until the height of summer to eat blueberries when they come in season if we want them in January. We're going to eat some nonsense that's been shipped from Chile in a container that takes weeks to get to us and doesn't remotely resemble a blueberry. I'm making a plea in that manifesto for folks to find that joy in cooking at home again. You know, it's become such an ogre with people these days that the joy of it's gotten lost, and everybody sort of goes through the same teeth-gnashing, hand-wringing, you know, spiel about, well, I just don't have time, and it's just such a chore. And there's no greater joy than creating something with a story to it and sharing it with someone. And whether it's meatloaf that your mom used to cook that you loved or your grandmother's biscuits or whatever it is, I mean, sharing that sustenance and that story with someone is something that it's getting lost.
Well, that's why I think your food is so unique and so special in so many ways in today's food world, because you cook real food. And not only do you cook real food, but you really tend to eschew trends.
Really, you know, we don't take ourselves too seriously. We're about pleasing people. It's never been about a greater artistic endeavor. It's, you know, I learned from the Brennans that what we do is about simply pleasing people, giving people exactly what they want so they return that butt to that chair as quickly as they can. So to sort of knock the shine off of what most folks might expect from this, you know, fine dining experience, I choose irreverence, and it serves us well. I mean, it's just part of my personality, and I think if you asked my mother, she would say, yes, he has been exactly that way his entire life. And so the challenge to me in writing the book was finding a voice, and I tried for years in vain to sort of follow in the footsteps of John T. and Bill Neal and Frank Stitt and John Edgerton to contribute something to the scholarly conversation about Southern food. And every one of those guys that I just mentioned is brilliant. I on the other hand, am kind of a dumbass. And it took, you know, a couple glasses of bourbon and years of frustration sitting in my office one night that I finally said, you know, to hell with it. I can't say anything that any one of these guys has not already said. And I'd been told forever, just like, tell stories like you talk. You know, like you write these off-the-cuff emails, you know, they're hilarious. Just write like that. And so I did. And it's a little vulgar, but that's the way
that's
I talk.
You. It's, yeah. Why else do they call you Big Bad Chef? So tell me, from BevNap to Hardback, how long was it in the making?
About just a little over 2 years.
Wow. Good job. Well, I'm going to hand you one of my pet peeves. John. Lean Parent has been making the original Worcestershire sauce since the early 1800s. So why do you think we have to start making it ourselves? And how are we going to improve on something that is an established classic since the 1830s?
Well, I would say, you know, and this is not to be absurdist, but you could argue the exact same thing about French's yellow mustard. Sometimes there's absolutely no substitute for French's. We just set about years ago identifying things that we like and challenging ourselves to develop something similar to it or as close to it as we possibly could that we could say, hey, we made that. I want to say that my cue for sort of coming to understand these things and wanting to go through this process was inspired by Jamie Shannon. I think I remember shortly before his passing, Jamie aging his homemade Worcestershire in the kitchen at Commander's in little oak barrels. And it really sort of lit a fire for me in understanding what these things were more about. Like, why did I love them so much? And it, you know, it also became sort of a, you know, a processing, exactly why the book is broken up into chapters and technique. there was a running joke around our house as a kid that was always interesting at Christmas to my mom and dad, how long I would play with the toy before I then, you know, would sit there and stare at it and then get a butter knife out and start taking it apart to see how it worked. And that was just my, you know, my childhood in a nutshell. And I think it sort of it defines me a little bit. I'm fascinated with how things work.
Okay, so I'll buy this but now I understand that really all you're trying to do is get your readers to think outside the box, cook outside the box, and maybe have an adventure that they might not normally have. Okay. Out of everything, what are you most proud of in this weighty tome that is your first book?
No, that picture of my beautiful bride and the other one of my little naked baby that are in the very front of it. I couldn't be more proud of either one of those. But I think I am I'm saddled, or I should say, you know, for my whole life, you know, one of the most debilitating things that I've had to deal with is, you know, is some pretty serious self-loathing. And so through the process of writing this book, I remember thinking back to a conversation that I had with one of my roommates in college about writing a book, and that when you write a book, that's in ink, and that first edition goes to the Library of Congress, and it's there for all eternity. It's for my grandchildren, great-grandchildren, great-great-grandchildren can go and check Pickles, Pigs, and Whiskey out and go. That was my old man that wrote that. So it's a very permanent thing. And my fear is, you know, as a self-loathing Catholic, was that, you know, I'd get done with this thing and just hate it. You know, I'd looked at it so much or had enough self-doubt that, you know, it was something that I couldn't hang my hat on. And I love the book. I mean, not in a, you know, self-congratulatory way, but I love it because it speaks to exactly who I am.
That was John Kearns, author of Pickles, Pigs, and Whiskey. That's it for this week's edition of Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Next week, we'll explore the online food world of CNN's Eatocracy with managing editor Kat Kinsman.
A lot of the people who I follow on social media are farmers and chefs, and they're giving insight into the process of how the food comes onto your plate or comes into your store. And you're just getting these little windows into places you would otherwise never get to see.
Subscribe to our podcast, hear today's show, or catch up on previous editions anytime online at itsneworleans.com. Louisiana Eats is made possible with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen, Rouse's Markets, and Zatarain's. Have you made a love connection at Tales of the Cocktail? Our friends and sponsors at Dickie Brennan's Palace Cafe want to hear your story of love at Tales. Submit your story to love@palacecafe.com by Wednesday, July 9th. One lucky winner will receive a romantic dinner for two at the Palace Cafe and a pair of tasting room wristbands for all 5 days of this year's Tales of the Cocktail. Additional support for Louisiana Eats is provided by Linda Green, the Yakamen Ladies Soul Food Catering. Our media sponsor is Louisiana Life Magazine, the magazine of a great state. Original theme music by Johnny Sketch and the Dirty Notes. Thanks to executive producer Thomas Walsh and sound engineer Joe Schreiner. I'm Poppy Tooker. We'll see you next time. Louisiana Eats is a production of WWNO and the University of New Orleans.